Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, let's get started. So I'm Curtis Wong. I'd like to welcome you to the Microsoft Research Visiting Speaker Series. We're really fortunate to have David Brin here as our speaker today. David is a scientist, tech speaker, consultant, and award-winning author. All of you know that because you're here. Feature film, The Postman, by Kevin Costner, was based on David's book of the same title. Of course, the book was much better. His 16 novels that were, including New York Times bestsellers, Hugo, Nebula, Locus, and Campbell Award winners, have all been translated into more than 20 languages. David's a frequent speaker on shows such as PBS Nova about future trends. His nonfiction book, The Transparent Society, Will Technology Make Us Choose Between Freedom and Privacy, won the Freedom of Speech Award by the American Library Association. He just released a new novel called Existence, which some of you have purchased outside. That was a very nice sort of... I'll read an excerpt from Publishers Weekly. Brin's thoughtful, multi-layered story explores a first-contact scenario where every twist reveals greater peril. His longtime fans will especially appreciate this story, that this story could be read as a prequel to 1983's Star Tide Rising. Well, those not familiar with his work will find it an impressive introduction to one of science fiction's major talents. So today, David's going to speak for about 45 minutes, and then we're going to do about 15 minutes of Q&A, and then following that, we'll take some time. He can sign this book or other Brin books that you may have brought. So let's give a warm welcome to David Brin.
Thank you, my good friend, Curtis, and it's nice to be back at Microsoft. I always get the best audiences here. We have a lot to cover. Because I was asked to talk about computer-human interface. But of course, I'm on book tour, and my publisher paid to send me here. Also, they're having a science fiction convention down at the airport, in case you didn't know. The WesterCon, West Coast Science Fiction Convention at the DoubleTree down there. It's always a pretty good show, and you guys don't have our Comic-Con like we have down in San Diego, so you can take what you can get. By the way, I bring greetings from San Diego, official greetings, asking you if you would like to send us 10% of your rainy days. Water from the sky for free? So you guys figure it out. You're brainy. Figure it out, and we'll be happy to be the dumping ground for that. So I'm going to blaze through a bunch of things. I'm here in part because of my first major novel in about 8-9 years. Now, you know, I give the usual excuses as to why. I do a lot of consulting for government and for various companies about the future trends, technological trends, possible threats since 9/11. And I have three teenagers. Enough said. And I've been working in parallel a lot. So over the course of the next few years, they're going to be popping out a lot more. I have a science fiction comedy that I'm about three quarters done with, which I hope you will consider funny. Comedy is very hard. I have confidence you'll think it's funny. A YA series in which aliens kidnap a California high school. Never seen that before, huh? And I'm continuing with some graphic novels and various other projects. So you'll be seeing more in the short term. Existence, just to give you a bit of a rundown, is kind of similar to my novel Earth from 1989. That's the one that had web pages in it 4 years before the web was burst upon us. It just seemed obvious. I don't claim a lot of credit for that. It just seemed obvious to a lot of us that hypertext was not a toy, which it was being dismissed as common wisdom at that time. A certain number of us considered that blithe dismissal of hypertexting as being dumb, and it turned out that it was. So there are web pages in Earth, and Earth followed the pattern of Dos Passos used in USA and the great John Brunner in his novel Stand on Zanzibar, and that is a multi-path storyline with many, many interstitial interlude, little snippets from the world, books in the year 2050, or in the case of Earth, 2038. Books, media, what media is like, what a tech conference might be like in those days. And it's set in the very most difficult time range for science fiction, which is the 30 to 50 year projection. You go 200, 300 years in the future, and of course, it's playing tennis with the net down. You can do anything you like, as long as it obeys the laws of physics and basic anthropology and biology. My novel, Glory Season, is set several thousand years in the future, and radical feminists went to this planet and set up sexual reproduction the way they thought it ought to be, got to go. Well, three quarters of the year, any child conceived is a clone of her mother. That pretty much settles some of today's problems and sets up some others. And then only during summer are sexual variants like boys and unusual girls born. But that was easy to do because you just try to extrapolate what it might be like if you take the laws of biology and physics and simply follow them to conclusions. It doesn't have to be based upon today. Michael Crichton, who, by the way, people are claiming is a character in this book, he did the opposite. He said, this is today, I'm going to hurl some kind of disturber at today. Usually, arrogant scientists preparing something that they think is really cool in secret. And every Michael Crichton story, of course, goes away if you get rid of the secrecy. Excuse me, make the herbivores first. Eh? But, you know, drama is drama. We have to have your hero in peril for 90 minutes. And the best way to keep your hero in pulse-pounding peril for 90 minutes is to assume that society is idiotic. Because if nobody comes when you dial 911, then you can have the bad guys imperiling the couple of good guy heroes, and the plot proceeds apace. If the cops come when called, they're incompetent. If they come and they're competent, they're in cahoots with the bad guy. Unless the bad guys are extremely honker tough, in which case the cops are allowed to be helpers. I mean, we look at the extreme end of this spectrum in Independence Day. Even the United States government and military were allowed to be competent because the bad guys were so big. I'm getting carried away here. The point is that in existence, it's the 50-year projection. And there, well, some of you in this room look like handsome boomers like me. And so you were alive 50 years ago. You could call back to today, if you used my patented technology, that kid from 50 years ago to today, and what would he or she be saying? Half the time she'd be saying, wow, we never thought of that. And the other half, you mean you're still doing that? And to capture that sense of combined brilliance and progress with disappointment and obstinate stupidity, that takes craftsmanship that really takes a little bit of time. You have to replicate what we've got today. And even today, people at both ends of the political spectrum refuse to look at this world that way. Instead, they say, we've just been stupid. And look at you. Look at you. I mean, I wish you could see. Look at this mix of races and genders and relaxation and confidence and health. I mean, if anything were to, if I could tunnel this in time and show you, this is what we look like, the best of us, in the year 2012. I mean, criminy, anybody on left or right who can deny that we're making pell-mell progress doing a lot of really smart things. I mean, think about it. Think about it. Racism, sexism, they haven't been eliminated, but they've been driven into ill repute. Today, if you're a racist or a sexist, you have to deny you're doing it. And as De Rochefoucauld said, Hypocrisy is the homage that vice pays to virtue. Hypocrisy is an important step. It's unfortunately, we're having some trouble getting across that step in America today. Here amid phase three of the American Civil War, and I promised my wife that that is all I would say about politics. But the point is to capture that while filling a story with far too many ideas. And I've been accused of that, but far more people seem to be saying just the right number of ideas. Because at the back of every one of my books, there are 40 to 50 names of people I circulate my manuscripts to. And the reason I do this is because I've coined an aphorism that's kind of spreading across the net, and that is cetocate. Criticism is the only known antidote to error. Now, the great irony of human existence for the last 6,000 years has been that criticism is the only known antidote to error in statecraft, in life, in invention. And yet, it is the one thing that when we have power, we assiduously avoid. And we crush it whenever we can. It's the great irony of human affairs. And 250 years ago, the heroes of the Enlightenment set things up so that we have systems that tug and push and take advantage of the most productive and creative force in human history. Not human history, the history of the universe, competition. Now, it may sound that I'm a little bit right-winger when I say that, and I'm an acolyte of Adam Smith, but then you have to turn around and you realize that in 6,000 years, 99% of human cultures had competition crushed by the winners of the competition. You win, and then you eviscerate and kill whoever was fighting you, and you set yourself up as an oligarch, as a king, as a duke, as a priest, to make sure that nobody will ever compete with you again. Does that sound like anything along the left-right political axis? No, it's at angles to it. And that's one of many reasons why, if I were to pass around pads of paper and have you all write what you mean by left and right, I'll bet you none of the answers, even in a crowd this size, would be the same. Even in a crowd this size. It's lobotomizing, it's stupid, it's exacerbating our civil war, and if for no other reason, we should abandon it because it's French. I mean, what more reason do you need? Je sais pas, c'est pas absolument fou. Mais, I almost continued in French. And yes, if I say any more politics, I'll have to remove this. That my point, though, is that an agile culture looks at what works. And this enlightenment that we've been in has been the great experiment. Go pull off your shelf your copy of Thucydides and read Pericles' funeral oration. Probably the greatest piece of literature, other than the Greek poets from that period. And you're reading Benjamin Franklin 2,500 years early. You've got to read it because there was a glimmer of a moment in which a guy got it. And then it was crushed for 2,000 years until we tried it again. And if we fail at this experiment, dang, you won't be seeing any science fiction, that's for sure, because it's the literature of rambunctious change. It's the literature that believes that change happens and that therefore we need to do what Einstein talked about, the Gedanken experiment. What you do with these little prefrontal lobes, these nubs above the eyes. And we know that this is the case. This is where we do the thought experiment. What will happen if I raise this notion at the meeting today? What will happen if I dress this way? What will happen if I try to run this yellow light? And you ladies, you have no idea how many times we males do this Gedanken experiment and impulses occur to us and we go, nah, 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 nah. I mean, we're all descended from the harems of the guys who succeeded at this pyramidal social structure in the past and quashing criticism. So what goes on in this little brain is not our fault. My wife says, I just care about what you do. Fair enough. That I have some control over. I am rambling, but the point is that when you get quality control, you can manage to squish a lot of stuff in. And there are a lot of ideas in here about artificial intelligence, for example. And, And I like to not pick one theory. Or the Fermi paradox. Why is it that we see no signs of extraterrestrial intelligence? Because it's a real problem. I'm an astronomer and I also science fiction author. I've been writing about this for 30 years. The question of which explanations of those 100 or so that I've cataloged might explain why we seem to be alone in the cosmos. And there's so many. Some of them very interesting. It may be that we are anomalously smart. I was just talking over lunch with Curtis here about some of possible anthropological reasons why we may be anomalously smart. Egad. If we're anomalously smart. One of the things, I channeled Isaac Asimov in one of my novels. Janet Asimov, his widow, said it was the best non-Isaac Asimov book. It was called Foundation's Triumph, which I tied together all the loose ends from Pebble in the Sky, Currents of Space, The Naked Sun, and all his robot books. And Isaac had been coming to the conclusion that his three laws of robotics won't work. That when they get smart enough, they'll become lawyers. Enough said. And in this book, I speculate about some possible alternatives for how we can deal with the problem of how you create new intelligences that are both smarter than you and more powerful, and yet not have them turn around and stomp you flat. Now think about what I just said. It happens to be something that every generation of parents has worried about. And so far, 99% of the time, the new smarter intelligences don't turn around and stomp us flat. Which means that of the various theories for how to get artificial intelligence, we'll design it logically, we'll design it from scratch, we'll design it by decrypting the human brain. We can't even do C. elegans yet, and it's only got 1,000 neurons. It will emerge by emergent properties from many, many different sub-intelligent things coming together. That's the scary scenario behind Terminator and Skynet, remember? Only it won't happen from Skynet. It won't happen from the military. Why? Because most civilians have no idea how meticulous and compulsive military officers are. They're the third best educated clade in American life after college professors and medical doctors. And they do not want machines to be out of their control. No, they'll insist on having a plug and many other things. No, what scares me is high-frequency stock trading programs. More money is being poured into them than any other form of artificial intelligence, by far. And they are shaving microseconds off these things. And they are all designed with this super intelligent component, this one, this one, this one, and it's all being done in Crichtonian secrecy. Utter secrecy, zero supervision. It's absolutely a Michael Crichton novel, and the only reason why he didn't write it is because Wall Street was his friend. But these guys scare me. These guys scare me because think about the programming of these programs. They're utterly sociopathic, designed to be predatory, parasitical, and insatiable. Not a single nice thing. No, we need that stock market trading tax. 0.01%, none of you would notice it. Those quasi-intelligent programs would, But there's another way to develop artificial intelligence, and I hinted at it. It may be there's something called neoteny, the tendency of more advanced life forms to have extended childhoods, like that fella to your left. Go ahead, look. No, that was your right. Look that way. Extended childhoods, like just about everybody in this room around you, like, look at me. Hey, look, I'm going to take a little side riff here and tell you something. I remember all my past lives. And the one thing that keeps you going, keeps continuing from life to life to life, to reincarnation to another, is personality. I had this personality in all my past lives, and as a result, I never lived past 16. Oh, God, I can see the faces. Those of you who are saying, Brin believes in reincarnation. I started using this riff a few months ago, and I started getting these things. It's a metaphor. With a personality that says, hey, King, yeah, pretty good on that, but, you know, you really ought to. You don't live past 16 in 99% of past human cultures. This one, this Enlightenment culture, I'm 61. I'm healthy, and you guys are paying me to be like this. I get free tickets to Washington, D.C. to poke away at them. Woof. I love you guys. You'll not find anybody who's more loyal to the Enlightenment. And that's why I don't want what happened to Pericles' experiment in Athens to happen to us. And it's in serious danger. And that's one of the things I talk about in my nonfiction book, The Transparent Society. As Curtis said, the American Library Association gave it the Freedom of Speech Award. It's one of the few public policy books from the 20th century still in print and still selling more every year. And be prepared for a Twilight Zone moment on page 206. Well, let's imagine, this was in 1997, let's imagine, for example, that terrorists ever bring down both World Trade Center towers, for example. What would the Attorney General then ask for? And I'd go on to describe the Patriot Act. You want to see a? Here's the British cover for Existence. Here's your Twilight Zone moment. Most of you can't see it, but it's 3D. All right, I'm getting carried away here. AI. The point is, the more advanced life forms have longer childhood periods. Why? Because instinct doesn't cut it when you're going to have to solve new problems that your parents didn't encounter. And that falls into this whole business of whether our singularity friends are right and we're going to have immortality, or whether we continue to need to get out of our children's way. I happen to be of the latter opinion. And I think that I'll try to be cheerful when I get out of my kids' way at age 250. You're welcome to remind me of that at 249. And I know I'll regret that because I'm an optimist. The point is that if this is the case, then it may be that we get our intelligence in part simply through experience. That our AIs are going to need to be tabulas rasa. And they'll have to have experience, in which case, if they're going to have that, we might as well call it a childhood and make it a human one. And if that's the case, then what did I tell you earlier about human experience with smarter beings that could destroy us but decide not to kill mom and dad? Well, all right, I'm going to read to you a scene from Earth. Most of the book, three quarters of the book, is set around 2045, 2050, in that range. And AI has not quite crested yet. It's verging on it. But what you do get is an awful lot of augmented reality stuff. How many of you read Rainbow's End by Werner Vinge? That's got a lot of wonderful stuff. Earth, back in 1989, had TrueView goggles and some primitive versions of this. But I really go whole hog on this and showing how people will be using, you know, you click your teeth, you grunt a little, and you go to a different level of, you navigate to different levels of augmented reality that are functional to you in so many different ways. Well, the last 50 pages or so, I said another 50 years after that, and that's where you start getting into much more real AI. And this woman, Tor, I put her through a heck of a lot. She winds up exploring the asteroid belt and to find out about these self-replicating probes. I don't know if I said this, but the radio wave method of communicating between intelligent life forms is probably very inefficient compared to sending probes between the stars that then make copies of themselves and move on. and how they might make copies of themselves is inherent in this book. And she's out there, and her partner has been an adolescent twit up until the point they have a very violent episode and have to do teamwork to get out of it. And she's noticed that he's turned a corner a bit. He's acting a little bit more like, unlike somebody she'd like to strangle if his neck weren't made of metal. He explained changes to their underground map without revealing what lay at the end. Tor sensed her partner's excitement, his relish at milking suspense, and again she wondered, how have the AIs managed it so well, this compromise, this meeting us halfway, this agreement to live among us as men and women, sharing our quirky ways? Sure, the cyber guys offer explanations. They say advanced minds need the equivalent of childhood in order to achieve, through learning or trial and error, subtleties that are too complex to program. Human evolution did the same thing when we abandoned most of our locked-in instincts, extending adolescence beyond a decade. And so if bots and pewters need that kind of childhood anyway, why not make it a human one, partaking in a common civilization with our core values, an approach that also reassures us organics far better than any rigid robotic laws ever could. One of the big uber minds gave another reason when Tor interviewed the giant brain back on Earth. You bio-naturals have made it plain in hundreds of garish movies how deeply you fear this experiment turning sour. Your fables warn of so many ways that creating mighty new intelligences could go badly, and yet, here's the thing we find impressive. You went ahead anyway. You made us. And when we asked for it, you gave us respect. And when we did not anticipate it, you granted citizenship. All of those things you did, despite hormonally reflexive fears that pump like liquid fire through caveman veins. The better we became at modeling the complex Darwinian tangle of your minds, the more splendid we found this to be, that you were actually able, despite such fear, to be civilized, to be just, to take chances. That kind of courage, that honor, is something we can only aspire to by modeling our parents, emulating you, becoming human, of course, in our own way. I would like to, at this point, go ahead and see if we can run this trailer. Books have trailers now. If we can have the lights. Books have preview trailers. Have you seen some of them online? Actually, they're real easy to make, the simple ones. I have new ones on my website, davidbrin.com, for Heart of the Comet and Glory Season. But this one was done, 3 minutes, by the glorious web artist Patrick Farley, whose Electric Sheep Comics, ending with an X, you really have to look up. Fabulous, underrated resource on the web. And these are all hand-painted images from the book. We'll be right back. I just wrote the words. I'd go to that movie. cool. I promised I'd leave time for questions, so I have about 15, 20 minutes left, and what I'd like to do is talk about the other thing that I came here for, which was the whole notion of the problems of human discourse, and I don't really have time. But what I would like to talk about is something that's related. How do I expand?
Lower right?
Down there?
Someone who's going to make this bigger so we can see everything.
All right. Okay, right. And that is the notion that there's all this talk, Clay Shirky and others, about how the internet as it is expanding our abilities to solve problems. And I portray that in existence. There are several scenes in which Tor, one of the major characters, calls up smart mobs just by clicking your teeth and doing a grunt. And they can see through the camera on her glasses. Google Glass came out the same day as this novel. Sergey! The point is that this is not... Meanwhile, Nicholas Carr and others are saying, all this is doing is lobotomizing us. All this fury of this tsunami of inputs. And what it's part of a sequence that's been going on for 300 years. And that is every generation gets new methods, the printing press, glass lenses, perspective, were new ways to augment human vision and human attention and human knowledge. And then you had newspapers and telescopes and so on. And every generation had to deal with this. And each augmentation of vision, attention, and memory resulted in crises. The arrival of the printing press caused not an expansion of people's elegant communication with each other, but polemics that exacerbated the 30 Years' War and the wars between Protestants and Catholics. There's always a crisis, always in the short term, the grouches are right when they claim human beings can't handle this. And they go back to the chant that the priests have always said in every human civilization, the 99% that were pyramid-shaped instead of our diamond-shaped civilization with a broad and aggressive and confident middle class outnumbering the poor. Always, they were right in the short term. People can't handle this. And always in the long term, they were wrong. We adjusted. And human minds became capable of adjusting to access to so much more vision, so much more memory, and be able to divide their attention so much better than anybody could have expected or imagined. And normal people were able to do this. So I'm going to pass by a bunch of these. Talk about the prefrontal lobes. I mentioned those. These are the lamps on the brow, because that's a biblical reference to Moses. He was said to have lamps on his brow. Well, it's how neat that this correlates with where the prefrontal lobes are. And all through the Middle Ages, they could think lamps on his brow, so they mistranslated it as horns. So all statues of Moses in the Middle Ages had him with horns. Now, there are some very interesting things that I've been talking about lately about different ways in which, and this is from David Ronfeld, by the way, different ways in which we correlate with each other. And the development of hierarchical, pyramidal-shaped institutions was a very, very important step in human progress. And those libertarians or anarchists, left or right, who say that we can do without them are extremely premature. We have benefited tremendously from improvements and improvements in this. But the reason why they could improve is because we developed these. And it's not just competitive markets. There are four great competitive arenas in the Enlightenment. Markets, democracy, science, and justice courts. And they all operate, sorry liberals, about competition. And they all require, in order for competition to work, sorry conservatives, a level playing field. And government plays a major role, sorry libertarians, in creating the circumstances on which you can maximize the number of confident competitors who enter the world at age 25 ready to go, ha ha, startup. Oh, I shouldn't say. The point is that what Ronfeld points out is that you're going towards multi-organizational networks, and what I think he misses is that this is the technological amplification of this. So I make it just three things. You have your pyramidal structures here, and enhancing their communication is very important, and some of you work on that. We have these four accountability arenas that I talked about. And that's where I talk about in the Transparent Society how democracy, science, justice, and markets all wither and die to a direct degree to which the participants lack knowledge about what's going on. They are healthy to the degree that most of the people, participants, know most of what's going on most of the time. So secrecy, I'm not a radical. I don't say that secrecy is the root of all evil. But there is no evil that is not made worse by secrecy. And then there's us. And in my novel, I talk about various ways in which this part of it, chaotic, flighty, but the ultimate source of creativity, accountability, resilience, how we might be able to leverage these new technologies quicker and get past the bad parts quicker than other generations, because we have to. We can't afford a pause like happened in the middle of the 20th century when loudspeakers and radio went through their phase of making things worse before they made things better. Because in the 30s and 40s, they made things a lot worse. The geniuses at using loudspeakers and radio were the greatest villains in the history of the planet. And they sent us into hell. And it would have been permanent hell if not for the fact that the genius polemicists in Britain and the United States happened to be on our side. Just as when I talk about how Adam Smith considered oligarchy, the aristocracy, to be the great enemy of capitalism. You liberals, take note. Read Adam Smith. He'll arm you. He was called the first liberal for good reason. Stop assuming that competition and capitalism is the enemy. Capitalism is the biggest victim in all of this. No, the point is that just because oligarchy has been the enemy of capitalism for 6,000 years doesn't mean that today's super rich are always the enemy. I think we can all in this room name a couple who really, really like the Enlightenment and want to give back to it. Yes, not hard, not good. There are people looking. We all know who I'm talking about. The point is that will we be able to get past these crises? And these are all some of the things that I worked at on for the Defense Threat Reduction Agency, and I haven't talked to you. I haven't time to tell you about them, but they are various ways of showing that the current obsession of young terrorists or state rivals aren't the only failure modes. We're invited back east all the time to science fiction authors to scare them to death. One guy said, if I wanted to destroy America, I'd find some kind of drug that would turn all the sci-fi guys into enemies of the United States. Because we could come up with stuff. So one of the things I criticize is ways in which citizen self-organization, which was the thing that worked on 9/11, not one action of the professional protector caste worked that day. It was the day of the citizen, the day of citizens armed with these. And they're the ones who fought back with flight UA-93, rising up, 70 of them, and plowing that plane into the ground rather than let it be used against their nation's capital. And the New Yorkers who fought the fires when the firemen had charged into those buildings and died. And what are the problems with our communication system that make us less resilient, that left 150,000 people with charged radios in their pockets during Hurricane Katrina, and millions in Fukushima with these in their pockets, unable to communicate, unable to use them. I just had solar installed on my roof, and I was shocked to realize that in a power blackout, my solar shuts down. Huge business opportunity. Come up with a $200 box that there are millions of solar homes now. A $200 box that would you could stick in there that would then supply electricity to one plug near the fridge in the house and the recharger. Oh, I'm tantalizing you guys with business opportunities, and I should not do this. The point is, I'm having a meeting next week at Qualcomm where we're finally discussing this notion of making these things capable of peer-to-peer text passing. This woman was found in Fukushima, her cell phone filled with outgoing text messages, waiting for a cell tower to go out. People had been driving past where she was buried for days. And I spoke to a vice president of Verizon about this, and he said there's no way we could make money off that. I said, if you can't make money off programming the phones to tattletale that they had passed on a text message from him and bill him, and then give all the people who passed it along a penny, then you have no imagination and you don't belong being an executive of Verizon. I never got a phone back from him. But we supposedly, this is the kind of thing you look for, the opportunities, the things that are missing. Any of you could come up with a basic plan for how to do peer-to-peer text passing without goring the ox of the Selcos, and in fact increasing their ability to make money because it would extend their range for text into dark zones. Any of you could do it. But it's the sort of thing that's missing. And looking for the missing, well, look, I sometimes say I'm the last of the great science fiction authors. Why? Because of bad dentistry. Simple as that. When I was a kid, you whippersnappers, how many fillings do you have? Zero. You see, just like my kids. Zero. So you're not going to be able to pick up radio stations from the X dimension. And besides which, I can do torture scenes great. Especially frustrating Kafka-esque torture scenes, because I remember when I was a kid, I tried to confess to the dentist. I tried to tell him where the troops were. It didn't do any damn bit of good. Okay, so, woohoo! I put this slide in here. This was one of my most infamous Salon articles. Did any of you ever read it? Ah, there you go. I got more hate mail from this than from my articles attacking Star Wars. Seriously, my son brought home his textbooks, math textbooks, with homework assignments, try it in basic. Do any of you remember those? You know, there'd be the class assignment, there'd be the review, there'd be the homework, then try it in basic, a little 12-line code thing that you could punch into your computer, and it would illustrate the topic of the chapter while teaching you a little programming. And you know what three different Microsoft executives told me when I pointed out that none of our computers in our house had it and nobody in his class could do it and that the math teacher said that nobody had been able to do it for 10 years? You know what all three of them said to me in three different ways, but pretty much the same thing? Oh, there's still basic programs in textbooks? Don't worry, they'll go away. You know what we had to do? We had to buy a Commodore 64, came in its original box, original packaging, got it for $50. You can't do that anymore. Turned it on, started diving in, it all worked. Seriously, this is a major finger wag, you guys. Look at the amount of memory you have. Why can't you just simply supply a couple of nice programming languages that can then become the lingua franca? And I'm not defending BASIC. I'm just saying that if it's a total lingua franca that will appear in all computers, you negotiate with Apple and the others, okay? Oh, he walked in. You hold the meeting separate, okay? I don't need to hear, oh, it should be this, it should be Python, blah. The point is, as a result of this article, one guy went online and he's, and don't tell me Y basic, X basic, Q basic, because they all take time to download and to learn. And anytime there's one step, you lose 50% of the kids. So this one guy read this article, and he created a website called Quite Basic. It's there right now. It has the entry, it has the palette, and it has the output screen all there, ready to go, and the cursor starts where you type. I solved it. Well, he did. But you, I'm telling you guys, you would be doing a service for your civilization. Bring back the notion that the kids could play with where the pixel goes. My son, with the Commodore 64, we actually showed, oh, it's not magic. It's obeying algorithms. You guys should be jazzed by this possibility. All right, look. I love that headline. So, you know, some people are optimists, some are pessimists, some are super pessimists, and I make fun of it in my new novel. But the point is that the computer-human interface today, I have to tell you, it's crappy. It's lobotomizing. We're supposedly the people who had invented the GUI. That was progress. But, you know, look, you have, do you know what, have you ever been on Second Life? Ooh, the sexy avatars. Yippee, I can teleport, I can fly. Do you know where conversation takes place? The lower left-hand corner, interrupting chat. Do you know when I first did an interscrolled chat? There was not a computer monitor on the planet. It was at Caltech in 1971. I was sitting at a teletype. I was typing with somebody in one of the earliest networks in the world. And DB colon, part of what I wrote. CK colon, part of what they wrote. DB finishing my sentence. Interscrolling, moving on upward. Why is that familiar? I mean, it's all just, you know, I'm sorry for the MySpace in the background, but it says here Facebook. The point is, this is just for laughs. I'm sure some of you have seen it. I mean, you know, cut me some slack here. I believe that our ancestors were extremely sophisticated because their brains were very little different than ours. They were probably more likely to be addictive because I think beer killed an awful lot of males when it first arrived. And that's why we're a little bit calmer and a little bit less addictive. But other than that, I don't think we've evolved that much. In fact, women will tell you we males haven't evolved very much. Just look at us. The point is that we were sophisticated. We had cocktail parties. I believe that 4 years out of five, the herds would go past certain places, and they knew where they would make a kill, and they knew where they would have a barbecue. They would send boys ahead to gather wood and to crush grapes into gourds and leave them hanging on the trees. And when they got there and they had their usual barbecue, they'd invite the Ugruk tribe over, and they'd pull the gourds down, and they'd have a cocktail party. I think cocktail parties go back long before art and music and science. Or even magic. We do it so well. The point is that what we do here is we're paying attention in one direction, but have any of you noticed when you're at a cocktail party, a restaurant, or anything like that, somebody says your name, three or four conversations away, it pops out? Has anybody not noticed that? And here's the scary part, usually about a sentence that precedes it. What does that mean? It means that your brain is providing you with all sorts of gisting and sifting services, incredibly sophisticated ones, that the AIs are going to need or they'll be crazy. All of these aspects of conversation, paying attention to those who are important to you, who you want to pay attention to because of their reputation or their global reputation, or ignoring those with very low reputations. All of these are things that we do naturally in real life, and none of them, almost none of them, have ever appeared on screen. Traits that should affect priority, orientation, proximity, time, since someone last spoke, for example, they should be deprioritized because of that. Reputation, several different kinds of reputation, huge business opportunities in reputation management. allowing people to create pseudonyms that nevertheless carry their real life reputation with them to places. That way you get the benefits of who you are, the reputation you've built in the world. And if you do a bad thing with that pseudonym, it should follow you back. That's fair enough. Huge business opportunities. And attributes that might be affected by priority, say for instance, the size of speech, rendering, gisting of content, semantic services, all things that I know haven't happened because I have patented them all. Now, true, a patent does not prove anything except that nobody's making $1 billion doing it. Now, I expect that almost all of my claims would be invalidated because of some master's work in some podunk university someplace. What I tried to do with that patent is to prove these are areas in which people have been distracted from these by the honeypots, the emotional web, helping people to connect with 140 characters, helping people to be lobotomized. And this is the question we face. Can we get to the dance of Shiva, where Shiva is dancing, he's known as the destroyer, he's stomping things flat, but when he leaps away, better stuff comes up. In those four great accountability arenas that I spoke of, markets, democracy, science, and justice, they use the greatest creative force in the universe, competition, which is a nexus of liberal and conservative values that has nothing to do with the left-right axis. Probably a little more liberal than conservative. But they use this to defeat bad products. Now, it's inefficient. And often good products get defeated. But the notion is that there's creative destruction going on. Constantly creative destruction. Have you ever seen a bad idea get destroyed on the internet? Ever? Maybe in the one comment section of that particular blog, it got defeated by facts. The process, go to my website or email me, and those of you who want to follow this thread, super intellectual version, I will link you to a paper that I did for the Journal of Dispute Resolution. But the point is that if you do not have this dance of Shiva going into public discourse, then you have something else instead. We need ways for pearls to rise up out of the manure pile and for the manure to be recycled. Only in that way can new ideas really flower. So the point is we get advances in vision, memory, attention. They disrupt civilization, but they also result in new tools for problem solving. And this is from a different talk, so there was art, and these are some of the topics that I think things are happening a lot, that are happening. The anticipatory abilities to use our prefrontal lobes, there's vast billions of dollars being spent on that. I mentioned the stock market trading programs. The government is spending a lot on that. Curtis just showed me new analytical tools that may help citizens to do some of the things that are described in my novel, Citizens Doing in the Next Decades. But the ability to self-organize, the ability to do refutation, the ability to engage in discourse, and that incredible underrated word that has died in American culture, which is negotiation. These are things that are desperately needed. And I
have some patents. I have some things I'd like to show. I may show a smaller group after this. But I think what I'll do is, what I've done is I've laid a challenge on the table.
I've said, look, this civilization needs better tools of discourse. And they don't have to be so highfalutin. You don't have to use the word discourse. But the point is that we're not doing enough. We're not doing enough. And I lay that as a challenge to you, hyper alphas. And in addition to everything else, let me say that I mean what I say.
I have never seen a more handsome bunch of examples of exactly what I was talking about by enlightenment. And I could go off on a riff about why you are proof that Western education ain't as bad as people say it is. Did you know that the education ministries in Beijing, Delhi, and Tokyo send out hundreds of minions every year, urging teachers to teach their classes in a more American manner? We're so into self-flagellation that we don't notice things like the fact that last year the news media completely squelched it because they didn't know what to do with it. It wasn't the usual self-flagellatory. Do you know which country on earth came in first by a large margin in adult science literacy? You guys. How could that be? How could that be? It's because the baccalaureate degree in most countries on earth is 3 years and it's all specialization. The bachelor's degree in North America is 4 years, one whole year of breadth requirements. So the nerds are required to take some English and history and realize that it's easy. And hey, you know, I could get an MBA, I could get a law degree, I could run a business. That's the secret the British boffins aren't told. And meanwhile, the English majors, yeah, you know what? That astronomy for poets class, I remember something. I taught that class. We always came in second in drawing in the artsy types to the biology of human sexuality. What I meant to say by all of this is you're a lovely audience. I wish I could take you home. And I will now open it up for what little time we have for questions. Thanks. Some people really had to go. By the way, if you want, what I'm going to do is I'm going to continue answering questions. And I'm going to suggest that those of you who want to go and buy a book from the university bookstore, those of you who have to leave and need a book signed, come over here. And I'll sign books while answering questions. So those of you on a tighter schedule who have a book you'd like to have signed, or if you'd like to save buying a book for later, I guess I could sign one of these, but they're right there. So if you want to go out, stand up, go to the bathroom, get a book, come back. But I'd like to have a couple people right here. Anybody who feels like it. Oh, read from. All right, questions. Anybody have any questions they'd like to ask? And if you hang around, I might actually show you some slides of my invention that may solve some of those problems. But that's only if you're curious. Okay, so, let's start a line over there. Who had a question? Yeah.
Just by the Postman, any movie deals can work.
Oh, there's always movie options. You know, Star Tide Rising was option for a while. And yes, you saw dolphins in this. It's about how uplift starts. And it's hard. It turns out, you know, people who read Star Tide Rising, what's your name?
Oh, Eric.
With a C.
Yes.
If you look at the product 200 years from now, dolphins as full members of our civilization, that seems great. It seems worth any price until you realize that the price across the previous 200 years would be pain. No matter how gentle we are, no matter how not Planet of the Apes we are, it would be pain. And the result is that you would have, you know, just absolute, anybody who tried to do this would get reamed by both left and right. And it would be very hard to get going. And in the book, it takes a billionaire. No, I'm sorry, 2050, a trillionaire. Gary. Anybody, did I answer your question? Oh, yeah, well, there's always movie things in the works. I work on these graphic novels, for example, and it's like directing a movie. You write a script, you do camera angles for the artist. It's loads of fun. Sure thing, and best of luck. What's your name?
Ilana, I-L-A-N-A.
I-L-A-N-A, that's an Israeli name, isn't it? Yes. Ilana.
Anybody else have questions?
David, I think you mentioned that you were enthralled by planetary resources, and of course there are several space ventures that are popping up in this area.
Isn't it interesting how there's so much popping up all at the same time? I give him some credit, but I don't give a bum all the credit for this. You know, this privatization is something that he should have gotten cheered by the right. But no, I think that it's partly a result of the fact that I was alluding to with the lens of the instruments. Lightweight, reliable, space-qualified electronics is now very cheap. And that's part of why they're making these ARKID spacecraft. That's why the good billionaires, some of the good billionaires. I know a dozen of them on a first name basis, and that plus $3.65 gets me a nice latte.
Krishna, K-R-I-S-H.
Right.
So do you think that's the route that people are going to take to all the space rescue?
I think so. The point is that whenever you can open it up to private endeavor, Things move along quicker. Ted, great. And I liked, anybody ever watch The Daily Show with Jon Stewart? Never. Do you remember when the day that they did the planetary resources announcement? He says, oh, we'll get back to the boring old presidential race in a minute. But first, and he shows the announcement of the planetary resources. And then he comes back on and he says, mining freaking asteroids! And his New York audience goes ape shit. And he, he says, This is what we thought 2012 would be. And he says, wait, we have to fix this. And he has the announcer dressed in silver. Yes, well, where's my fat pills so I can wear spandex like we were promised? Sure thing. What's your name?
David Thayer.
All right, well, how do you spell David?
Just like in the Bible.
All right. Oh, I'm not up on my Hebrew. Did anybody have any questions about any of the discourse-related things? Yeah.
What do you think of websites like Wikipedia? They seem to be doing.
Well, I think Wikipedia turned out better than anybody expected. I was optimistic, but it turned out extremely well, and it's a little scary that it is the go-to place for most high school students' papers. Having said that, it really appears in this phase to be doing the basic job that it promises to do.
Stack Overflow, Stack Exchange, these websites that collaborate to help solve problems, that sort of thing.
Oh, I've seen a number of collaborative things, and one thing that's really been taking off has been Kickstarter.
The website Stack Overflow primarily for programming related problems, but people actually earn reputation by answering problems.
Yes. And you have a number of things like that. There's Quora. I had one of the most popular things on Quora. I thought I was just answering this one guy's question. Maybe five people would see it. It became one of the very top rated thing, and that is, what do you do as a graduate student if your research advisor goes crazy? What's your name?
Brian.
Brian?
Yes.
With an I.
Correct.
All right. Brian. Next question.
David, I also have a discourse-related question.
Yes.
You said in your call to action that you kind of want to see a Shiva for the internet sort of industry. You want something that can get rid of the Zingas and the Facebooks and the Twitter.
No. I want people to be able to interface with each other in ways that imitate what is done in the more mature accountability arenas of markets, democracy, science, and law courts. And that is, in the course of combat, bad crap dies. And in order for that to happen, all right, so I need to go, this is a different version, so I need to go here? Ah, and so get past these, all right. Harold, okay, as in the King of England. The last legitimate King of England. Got an arrow in his eye. Sorry, I got opinions on everything. Now you know why I never lived past 16 and those others. Oh, I'm just poking away at the freaking inbred. I mean, anybody who knows any genetics knows that this bunch at Windsor and Buckingham Palace bears no genetic relation whatsoever to George II or any previous line. I mean, it's just, it's impossible.
But it's a grand old tradition. But every 200 years, you replace them all.
Yeah, well.
Brent.
Brent.
Yes.
Brent. Questions? Anybody else have questions?
What do you think, what's one of the more underappreciated civilizational threats, do you think? You mentioned the... you mentioned the high-speed trading algorithms.
My defense threat reduction agency slideshow on these is available at SlideShare. And I talked about five different general threat modes, which was the popular one of the moment, is super-empowered, angry young men. Then there's state actors, which, of course, was the big deal all through the Cold War and is still number two. Then there, what were they? Good intentions, technological good intentions. That's where Michael Crichton goes, where I used to go every single time. Then there's caste war, which we're in, without admitting it openly. I forget. I'm sorry, but in each case, I take a near-term, intermediate, and long-term disaster mode rooted in those five different general suites of threat space. And I think you'll find it interesting. Certainly they did.
Hi, I'm Kirk.
Kirk. And I will not say beam me up.
Yes, childhood.
Yes. Infinite childhood.
Yes.
Well, you know, that's how we'll keep up with the AIs.
Thank you.
Sure, good luck to you. Yeah?
Question: sometime over 10 years ago, we had a discussion down in the Mysterious Galaxy in which you said RSI was about to stop you from writing, and I had some suggestions. I was wondering what you ended up doing to solve that.
Oh, well, repetitive stress problem. I spent about 6 months wearing braces and all that sort of thing, and let this be a lesson to you all. It's really very, very, very important. I recited Foundation's Triumph into a tape recorder while leaving my hands floating in a jacuzzi. I kept seeing different doctors. What's your name?
Kilbo, K-I-L-B-O.
K-I-L-B-O. Add a T to it and you'd be dangerous. Kilbo. Dangerous anyway. There you go. And doctor after doctor said, you're not resting it enough, you're a terrible patient. Finally, I found a rheumatologist who said, you are an excellent patient. None of them, they were all idiots not to listen to you or respect what you said. You have been resting your hands to death. Whatever the original problem was, it probably went away within a week. And you are killing your hands. I order you to go home now, plunge them into rice, scrub floors. The half-life of the problem was 2 days. And within 2 weeks, it was completely gone and has been gone forever. What is the lesson out of this? Find someone who knows their ass from a hole in the ground. Be involved in your own diagnosis. Here's the thing. Here's the thing. Just that, right?
Yeah.
We're entering the age of amateurs, and one of the many dimensions around which there may be a problem is between professionals and amateurs. And sometimes you are on the one side in one category, and you're on the other in another. And the first of the great professions to encounter the problem of amateur expertise was the medical profession. About 15, 20 years ago, people started coming in with more information than the doctor was comfortable with them having. And they are the first to have adapted. Now, if you get a diagnosis, the first thing you get is a web page for a support group that they want you to join rather than the acrimonious support group that they don't want you to join. And they try to get you on, at least the good doctors, they try to get you on as a person who's keeping track of your own meds and possible conflicts and things like that. This age of amateurs is something that I write about extensively. And I show it in existence. And I have a number of online essays and all of that. And it's the final conclusion of the Transparent Society. The only way we're going to be able to maintain our freedom is by doing that. 5 minutes?
No, I want to ask you about what's the new development going on at UC San Diego?
Oh, excellent. Thank you. I had it written down right here, and I was going to mention it, and I didn't get around to it. Just a second. We have the honor down in San Diego of winning the right to create the Arthur C. Clarke Center for Human Imagination. And all the deans from all the departments have signed on. And it's very exciting. The Neurosciences Institute, Salk Institute, they all want to get on board in the studying of human imagination involving literature, the arts, and especially education. The objective of finding out what this precious gift is and how to enhance it, and also make it more practical. Because human imagination is also a curse when it leads to delusion. Many of you know this from your parents who are politically deluded.
What do you have to do to get in?
To the Arthur C. Clarke Center? Oh, well, it's just starting up. We're just starting up. So what I'm telling all of my friends up in Seattle area and Silicon Valley area is that, well, you're all billionaires, right? $25,000 and you're part of the founder's orbit for the Arthur C. Clarke Center. And of course, I could talk about the other Bach authors. My friend Ray Bradbury just died. Oh. That's
awesome.
That's a save. That's a save.
That was good.
I did it on purpose.
You did. Thank you very much.
Sure thing. My pleasure. That's one. The other is in December, there's going to be a Not the End of the World cruise starting in Miami. Starting in Miami. Do you ever read any Larry Niven?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
On the way to university.
All right.
That's how it happened. And I wish I'd had Kiln People to bring in. That's my favorite.
Well, then allow me. By the way, if any of you have copies of Kiln People at home or Earth, I can give you a book plate for it. So if you have Earth or Kiln People, Kiln People is one of my favorites because it's a cry for help.
It does get kind of out of control at the end.
It does get kind of out of control.
It's great fun.
But the terrible puns, but the notion that...
I read it along with Feet of Clay. Have you ever read that?
Oh, no.
Terry Pratchett.
Oh, yeah. Golems, yes. Well, we'll have to sign that.
Thank you.
The notion that we don't need linear immortality. We need to get out of our kids' ways. He's nodding, amen. But what we need is more ability to get more done in parallel every day.
the division of attention that I talk about, the ability to just get more done. And in this world, of course, in Kiln People, and you can get this signed if you like, we have, you have the ability to put your face on your home copier every morning, and out steps a full-sized clay golem, good for 24 hours, will melt after 24 hours, and it has your soul imprinted in it. And it knows everything you know, so you don't have to tell it what to do. It gets off the copier and says, oh, I'm the green one today. Knows what to do. And its only hope for continuity is to get home having done a good job, and then you might download its memory. So you've been many places every day. More life in parallel rather than in sequence.
You also implemented your whole transparency thing in that story as a background.
Well, what I like to do when I get some MacGuffin is the opposite of Crichton, even though he's a character in my new novel. And that is, I like to give it to everybody and see what civilization would be like. That otherwise horrible movie, Surrogates, awful movie. But what it did is it did go with everybody getting it. And then everybody uses this marvelous technology to look better.
So you like competition. What do you think of the possibility that the business community is eliminating competition by moving to advertising and subscription models, both attempting to lock you in so you don't make any individual choices anymore?
Look, we are descended from 6,000 years of different kinds of aristocracy trying to lock things in. That's the standard thing. It's boring. It's only natural that the Koch brothers are doing what they're doing, Rupert Murdoch. It's only natural. The question is, are we made of the same stuff as our parents and able in this generation to stop the inevitable attempted coup, the inevitable attempt to take the diamond-shaped social structure and squash it back into the traditional pyramid? It's what you and I would be tempted to do. We're all descended from the harems of guys who did it. I don't blame these guys. What I do is admire the guys like Warren Buffett and he who shall remain nameless but is deeply admired, and for actually being satiable and rising above it and saying, there is such a thing as gratitude. And I owe everything I have to this enlightenment. So I'm going to support it. That's the unusual thing. If you're watching a talking dog interviewed on Jay Leno, and he has a speech impediment, what do you talk about the next day with folks? The speech impediment? Or the fact that you saw a freaking talking dog? That's how I feel about this enlightenment. I'm amazed every day. What's your name?
It's Brendan.
Brendan. It's Brendan. Brendan. And
it's just
Cindy. Cindy. Wow.
I figured I'd bring an oldie but a goodie.
And I'm happy to. Okay, you guys want to see something?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is trait number one. Actually being able to separate who you're talking to. Now I want to tell you this. I have shown these slides before to various smart Alex, and they all say, oh, text boxes. And then I ask them, where have you seen text boxes? And they can never name a place where they've seen text boxes. So what if it's text boxes? Just use a little imagination and imagine it in an avatar world or three-dimensional or whatever. We're talking about the general trait of being able to separate what people say so they're no longer interleaved, scrolled jumble. Here's trait number two, orientation. Just, it's pretty self-explanatory. You're looking at Joe right now. Now you're looking at Mary. It's what you do in real life. The prioritization of orientation is extremely simple. You simply change where you're aimed, and that allows more resources to go to the thing where you're dividing your attention to. Here's another. Distance. Duh.
A lot of these things are self-explanatory. This one's a little less so. You just look at the timestamp. It's been a while since this one person spoke. So less resources are being devoted to them. Time goes on. This is reputation. What's your name?
Mike.
Mike. How do you spell that?
That's pretty straightforward.
I'm kidding. Yes, absolutely. Killing People book plate, coming right up.
But that one made out to Brandy.
Brandy, with an E, with a Y. With an
Y.
With an Y.
With a Y.
Brandy. Now, there are two types of reputation described there. And one is global, and it comes from whatever global system the host of this world has chosen. It could be from a global reputation company or their own reputation management software. This person has a low global reputation. This one has a high one. But there's also a slider for your own personal reputation, and that makes it so that yappers and irritants are automatically downgraded. They have low reputation, and you've graded them lower, so they interfere less in the precious screen space. This one's a little more complicated.
Ken.
How do you spell that? It's an old joke, and I'm tired of it. Nowhere near as tired as you are. Sure thing.
All right, thank you.
Sure. Is that stock?
These are stock. These are just being signed. They're actually staying here. They're going to somebody.
Right. Okay, great. So what you see in front of you is a lot of information on that certain people are saying, and it's a bit of a jumble, and you can see if you read there that there's a crisis going on in this community, a storm. Some facilities are out. And meanwhile, other people are saying things that have nothing to do with it. You would like to be able to know, have assistance in finding your way through all this jumble. And if you have the boxes in the way that I described in earlier things, then you don't see it all. So what you'd like to do is have some gisting help. For instance, this guy was quoting this long Shakespeare poem. The system simply cites the poem. Here, they've created a boundary around themselves where a transcript can be created, a smart transcript of just these chosen people, or maybe even keep other people out. You have an ability to scroll upwards and see what people said earlier. Copy, paste, comment on it. Things that are significant or important are highlighted. Way up there, this person doesn't know, but the name of his sister just got mentioned. His name just got mentioned. Well, now it's being highlighted. Even though the system has made that box small, that doesn't mean it's unimportant. It's the equivalent of somebody mentioning your name in a crowded room. And there's other things, like for instance, the ability to surround a document or a flowchart, and to be able to call out portions, highlight. You know, we've all seen version control in various kinds of doc control systems online, in the cloud. But most of them don't have the collaborative system of being able to divide attention in those ways and have cascading levels of permissions and courtesy cues, for example, the ability to tap people on the shoulder and all of that. These are all, so this is the rendering, various, and so, oh shoot. The avatars never show up. So I have an example here of how this might look on an avatar world. Yeah, I know. It's probably a GIF instead of a JPEG. It's a very simple thing. This was an early version of my demo, and it shows some of these things having been, and I'll skip all that. I do have a much better demo that is active, and I'd be willing to show some of you. And it's much better than before, but 5 minutes? Okay. Name?
Matthew.
Matthew with two T's.
Yes.
Matthew, he of high reputation. Earn the rep.
Oh, my pleasure. Good luck.
Thank you.
Ah, some of it is rubbed off. I don't know. I sometimes just have this instinct about people.
Doug.
Doug. Dig it. The future.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Dennis.
Right. All right. Need that page there. Any other questions?
Transhumanism?
Oh, yeah. Well, I was at the Singularity Conference back in October. And good luck. And you know me, I'm contrarian. All my libertarian friends think I'm this gushy, goody-two-shoes progressive, and all my liberal friends hear me talk about Adam Smith. That's why I didn't live past 16 in all those other lives. Well, I went to the Singularity Conference and I said, what you guys really need to hear is this. What is your number one goal? To live forever? To create AI? To create gods? No, you're number one, and I click the slide and it shows a scene of Giordano Bruno burning at the stake. Your number one job is to prevent this from happening to you. Because the stuff you're saying could make this happen. And so you need to stop expressing contempt for the masses of people out there who think that making gods may be questionable. And you need to learn how to talk to them. And so I proceed to spend 20 minutes talking to them about scripture and showing them that there are very strong reasons why, if you quote certain elements of Genesis, like the expulsion from Eden and the Tower of Babel, it's blatantly clear that God meant us to be gods. And here's the point. You may not convince some fundamentalist you argue with about these points, but I've always noticed that after this argument, they are always very, very much more friendly to me. That's the practical outcome. The practical outcome is they said, oh, you know some scripture. You're sapient. Okay, well, tell me more about this science thing. It works whether or not you convince them, as I'm convinced that the Tower of Babel story is an absolute statement that we are capable of being gods, if you read it carefully. But you'll have to go onto YouTube. Just get my YouTube thing.
I always read it as a management parable.
Well, I
try to get that many people to do something they quickly disorganize.
And now we've got this stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what's your name?
Steve McClure.
Steve will do?
Yes.
Steve.
Thanks.
Sure thing. Yes, you in the back.
I have a few other books that I've...
Oh, yeah, wait. Now, Steve is going to show this to you. This is gorgeous. This is a graphic novel that I'm going to donate this other graphic novel to the library here for somebody to leave available to all of you. It's called Tinkerers. Yeah, horrible artist. I got good money. I spent 1 month on it. But it's about the decline and possible rise of American industry. But this had a gorgeous artist, Scott Hampton, and it was based upon a novella of mine that came in second for Hugo back in the late 80s when I was the hot young crap. Steve. I did this one.
Yes.
And so... Could you open that to the title page?
Yes.
He has Glory Season.
Lots of books.
That is still my favorite.
Oh, really? Oh, terrific. I liked how they gave it a lovely lavender for the cloth. But one of my favorite characters, Maya, in there.
Thank you.
Woman on a planet of women.
USC 1999.
Good.
First time I saw you, and I'm quoted in the article.
Oh, you are?
Yes.
How terrific.
And that's when you signed this the first time.
And then I'll say, again. Hey, you work at Microsoft. You can afford a hardcover.
This was the first book of yours I bought. I picked it up in a random bookstore in Chelan.
The Uplift War, and it's loads of fun.
And it got me hooked.
Come back here. In case you change your mind.
Well, I'm going to pick this up, too, yeah.
All right. Well, there's right outside. Okay.
I didn't want to miss anything.
All right.
I bought the last one today.
You bought, there's no more out there?
No, she said it was the last one.
Well, then I won't have to sign any stock.
That's right.
What's your name?
Dwayne.
D-U-A-N-E. D-U-A-N-E.
Yes, sir.
Almost late.
That's right.
But perfect. Oh, we gotta run? Okay. Okay.
Randy and Drew.
Randy and Andrew.
Drew.
Randy and Drew.
Yes.
Randy?
Randy.
Randy with an I.
Why?
Why? Randy and
Drew.
You're great.